the Savita Medical College team. It is going to be Shifa and Anne, right? So it's going to be something interesting on the abdomen, long case.
70-year-old female from Sriperumbatur came with the complaints of vomiting for the past 4 months. Patient was apparently normal 4 months back, after which she developed vomiting. The vomiting was 1 to 2 hours following food intake. It was non-bilious, non-projectile, containing the undigested food particles. She also complained of early satiety, postprandial fullness of the upper abdomen, ball rolling movements, loss of weight, loss of appetite, a generalized myalgia and weakness. No history of hematemesis, no history of melena, no history of fever, jaundice, abdominal pain, no history of cough, hemoptysis, breathlessness, no history of bone pains. Coming to the past history, patient was treated for the past 2 years for acid peptic disease. No comorbid history, no significant surgical history. Coming to the personal history, she gave a preference for spicy food intake. She is not a tobacco chewer, smoker, or an alcoholic. Taking mixed diet, no history of contact to TB. Coming to the menstrual history, she attained menopause. Her obstetric code was P3L3. No history of malignancy among the family members. So summarizing, a 70-year-old female came with the complaints of vomiting for the past 4 months with associated early satiety, ball rolling movements, postprandial fullness over the upper abdomen, with loss of weight, loss of appetite, and generalized weakness.
Moving to the general examination, she's a thin-built, poorly nourished, dehydrated woman. Pallor was present, there's no icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, pedal edema. Left supraclavicular lymph node was present. Left axillary lymph node was also present. Her vitals were, pulse rate was 80 beats per minute, BP 110 bar 80 mmHg, respiratory rate was 12, and temperature, she was afebrile. On inspection, after getting informed consent from the patient and with adequate exposure of the abdomen was found to be scaphoid and the umbilicus in the midline appearing to be normal. All quadrants moved equally with respiration. There was fullness noted in the right upper quadrant. There was no scar, sinus, dilated veins, pulsations, visible gastric peristalsis or visible intestinal peristalsis. Her flanks were free, hernial orifices free. Left supraclavicular fossa fullness present, the left axilla was free and there was no pigmentation, renal angle free and genitals were normal. On palpation, there was no warmth, non-tender. A mass was palpable in the right hypochondrium of size 2 cm in the vertical axis and 2 cm in the horizontal axis, which was irregular in surface, firm consistency, and the superior lead extended from 3 cm below the right costal margin at the right clavicular line, and medially it was close to the midline. I was able to insinuate the finger below the costal margin and the mass moved with respiration. It was less prominent on head raising test. No other palpable mass was found. Her flanks were free, no renal angle tenderness. Percussion over the mass was resonant. Pervaginal examination was normal and per rectal examination there was no melena or no rectal deficits. Systemic examination, CVS was, S1, S2 was heard. Respiratory normal vesicular breath sounds, seen as no neurological deficit, musculoskeletal system, there was no bony tenderness. So I would conclude by telling that this is a case of gastric outlet obstruction due to a distal gastric carcinoma involving the enteropyloric region.
Yeah, nice presentation. Only thing, you can go a bit slow, the tempo is a bit fast. So try to present in a slower pattern.
Yes.
But this is a long case. If it's a long case, I would expect a more detailed history. If you're talking about vomiting, what is the nature of the vomit is, what is aggravating it, what is relieving it, is it induced, is it spontaneous, is it bile stain, and hematemesis is there or not, melena, and it should be a more detailed history rather than a very, for presentation possibly you should write the salient features, but I would have expected a more detailed thing in a long case, and it went too fast as well.
The point is, as I said, you just go to the first slide when the case is 70 years, vomiting 4 months, is it not?
Yes.
Is it not? The vomiting, there's nothing, as I said, there's nothing mentioned about the vomiting. What is the nature? See, as a postgraduate, there's no differentiation between a UG and PG. You still have to say, because These are things which are going to indicate what is the nature, where is the obstruction, you know. Non-bilious, then it's outlet. It's bilious, then posterior duodenal. Then probably fecal, it's still distal. So you see, these, as a postgraduate, you should know all these things. And again, 4 months vomiting, early satiety, postprandial fullness, ball rolling movements. That's history of ball rolling movement? Yes?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes. History of ball rolling movement. Yes. Loss of weight, loss of day, all these things are there. But then, if you ask the history of, next slide you go there. Treated for APD 2 years. What is, we must not use abbreviations, first thing, so many ways the abbreviations are differ. No abbreviations in medicines, no? So that is one thing. Another one is, what, how long she was treated? 2 years. Was it a continuous, was it a discontinuous treatment? How was she diagnosed to have that disease? The postgraduate should know, no? She was treated for asymptomatic. Some GP goes on treating for some days and then treats. So you should know what is the nature of history. Whether it was a proven case of acid peptic disease. So that is how you have to go proceed on that. Understand?
Now, do you think the cause could have been an acid peptic disease in her?
With the permission of the chair, I warmly welcome the president-elect two of the ASI, Professor Abhay Dalvi, Professor of Surgery from the KEM Medical College, Mumbai. So, warm welcome, sir.
Welcome, sir. Welcome. Yes. Do you think that is going to be an APD getting converted to a malignancy or a de novo malignancy?
Ma'am, APD as such itself can also cause obstruction, ma'am. When it forms cicatrized ulcer.
So your case is now everything is going awry. So it is a cicatrized gastric ulcer going in for, this is not a case of malignancy then.
No, ma'am. Just got the history that she was on medications for that.
No. But in your presenting illness, you should have an idea whether you're dealing with a malignant or a benign case.
With the presenting complaints and with the complaints that she's having, it's more tending towards malignancy, ma'am.
Yes. Inna, sir? Mass irukku.
Starting from
there
the
is a mass
age,
also. So it is a malignancy. Now, about this APD, do you think somebody has missed anything? And what investigation they've done in those 2 years?
So endoscopy, she only was on and off. She was not, endoscopy wasn't done. Just in a nearby private clinic, she was on medications
for
it.
So you had a doubt that it is malignancy right from the beginning?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes? So you can always say that she was treated for some abdominal complaint for the past 2 years. Yes, you cannot commit that it is APD.
Okay.
Do you understand? You cannot say that it is APD getting converted to malignancy.
Okay.
So you're bringing in two diagnoses now. Okay? And similarly, malignancy is some family members, malignancies they are?
The diffuse type is more prone to run among families. Hereditary diffuse gastric cancer.
Oh, only gastric you ask for?
Breast cancer.
No, breast cancer as well, ma'am.
Yes. Lynch. Everything together. What is it called?
Krukenberg.
Lynch.
Malignancies. Okay? Yeah. So all those histories you should elicit, not only malignancy of the stomach. Okay?
Sir said we need more description about vomiting because it gives a lot of information.
I had mentioned, sir, it was non-bilious following 1 to 2 hours after taking food, and then it was non-projectile, not blood-stained.
Is it usually this is gastric outlet the end of the day? Any characteristic like that? Not in the early. They may have satiety, but usually they'll have a bout of vomiting at the end of the day because so much is dilated stomach, isn't it? Then vomiting is there, ball rolling movement is there, but why VGP is not there? Because 3 months is quite a long time to get a more peristaltic wave, isn't it? So why in this case it's not there? If it is not there, what is your diagnosis?
See, so much people are talking about vomiting, yes? So all of us have covered vomiting, yes? That means the history that you have said is a little inadequate. Okay, so we should also know the color of the vomiters. Did you say that?
Yes, sir.
Non-bilious, you said. It can be any color.
Containing food particles, undigested food particles.
So it is it undigested?
Undigested, I mentioned undigested. Yes,
so where does the digestion start?
It starts breaking down from the stomach itself.
From the stomach. Digestion starts from the stomach,
it,
is it?
It forms chyme.
From the mouth. Yes. So you chew the food and eat it. So do you think it's going to be undigested then? So it is a partially digested food because there is also the acid and your enzymes acting there. Yes. So it is usually a partially digested food. And then did you talk about foul smell or not? Did you tell me how many minutes or hours after she vomits?
1 to 2 hours.
And the amount? Yes, whether it is induced or not?
Spontaneous, ma'am.
Spontaneous. Yes.
So all these details you should say, it should just rattle out. We cannot keep asking you one by one, did you say this, did you say that, and you will be saying, I said this and that and all that. No? Okay, so vomiting, that is the only complaint the patient has got, and you have not elaborated well on vomiting. Okay, that is what all are trying to tell you. Got it? And sir wants to know, the patient has got vomiting, the patient has got ball rolling movements, but the patient doesn't have VGP.
How will you explain?
Yes, the explanation.
Can be possible, how will you explain? What is the ball rolling movement?
Patient can assess or feel her own.
So in this case, where it starts, where it ends?
From the left side coming to the right.
Okay.
Left to right, you can only say if there's an obstruction and you see a gastric peristalsis. That is ideal to say left to right. In the ball rolling movement, you can't say no. Something is rolling inside the stomach. That's all. That's a patient's sensation, symptom.
So actually, it indicates ball rolling is there, some hyperplasia of the muscles, isn't it? Some hyperplasia of the longitudinal or circular muscle, isn't it? More of longitudinal muscles, isn't it? So something is there, hypertrophy is a chronic phenomenon. It is not a day one. So it could be even a cicatrice ulcer, as madam says. VGP is more common in which? More commonly in which condition? A cicatrice ulcer or a malignancy?
Malignancy. Sorry, you should understand. That is the most crunchable part any examiner will catch around. See, malignancy, it is a proliferative thing that goes in a very short period of time when an obstruction occurs, if it is there. The point is, if you have an ulcer and a cicatrice, and you must have a dilated stomach for you to go have a malignant way of going through that. So it usually occurs in the cicatrice ulcer where you have a power. Technically a good VGP which comes around because the stomach over a period of time is dilated, hypertrophic, and then you will know what it is. Malignancy, you do not know. Remember gastric malignancy, then it immediately goes there. The time duration is very short. Ulcer duration is longer, so it takes longer time. The stomach also gets acclimatized to the partial obstruction which is occurring over the years. That is the problem.
Whenever you have vomiting and ball rolling, the chance that the patient will have clinical VGP is very high. One VGP is more common in a cicatrized duodenal ulcer for the fact, like sir said, timing, it's a longer duration. And with the past history of acid, suggestive of acid peptic disease, then it's likely that it's happened over a long period of time. The stomach has time to hypertrophy and you have more vigorous. So apart from the time, malignancy tends to spread in a submucosal and subserosal path. So the stomach is not as supple as you would see in a benign condition. So if you find VGP which is very positive and strong, it's more likely a benign condition. With the mass, there is no doubt it is malignancy. But if there is no mass and it's early growth, you're not able to feel the mass and there's a VGP, it's possible in both, but more common in a benign condition. But with the history of vomiting and ball rolling sensation, especially partially digested food, I probably think you would have missed out a VGP. You had, how did you look for VGP?
You have to sit tangential to the...
Talk into the mic, man, so everybody...
I sat parallel to the patient at it from a tangential angle.
No,
I was
before that, what will you check for? What will you do?
Just...
See, if you want to check a VGP, two things. You have to see that the patient in time down kathukiradhana no problem. See, first thing you should know, if you want to see a VGP and the patient has asymptomatic disease and there is a system ball rolling movement, you are not able to do a VGP, what will you do?
Ask them to have drinks.
You have to give not less, you have to give at least 500 ml minimum so that the stomach is dilated, we are able to assess the VGP. Otherwise, you will not be able to see a VGP. Understand?
Yes.
And another thing that will come to clinical examination, we should know what is. So, without giving a fluid, many times the VGP may not be very much visible because that is the problem. Unless the fluid is having a long stasis, lot of food and residue is there, you will not have a VGP. Okay.
Okay, shall we
proceed? You must see it in parallel. Yes, that you are right. No problem. Yes. You must stimulate the abdomen. It won't come just being water. You must just put a small tap. Hey, come, and then it will come. Okay.
Shall we proceed, sir?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, one more thing. In the surgical history, what previous surgery is very important in relation to CA stomach?
In whether she underwent any emergency surgery for a duodenal ulcer, perforated duodenal ulcer, or any for pyloric stenosis, whether she went any elective surgery.
Okay, like patient doesn't know the history, but says, I've had surgery for ulcer disease. Not sure whether it's a gastrojejunostomy or a perforation closure. How will you, based on history, elicit whether what surgery patient has had?
Whether she went on an emergency and the surgery took place on the same day, or whether it was a planned and it was happened after 2-3 days of her admission.
Looking at the abdomen, can you make out anything? Whether it was a gastrojejunostomy or a perforated duodenal ulcer?
With a drain tube.
Drain site is... You don't keep her brain for
scar
size. Scar size, yeah.
Can we proceed, sir?
Please go
General examination.
See, actually, for PGs, we take it for granted that the history and examination, you will know very well. Yes, so we concentrate more on investigations and management. So keep going.
For this patient, I would like to investigate. First, initially, I would like to do a complete blood hemogram. And in that, I would like to check her, the hemoglobin levels because she will be having anemia. And this.
What importantly, you would like to see is only is not anemia. That's what our surgeon is very concerned that patient does not have gas anemia or a jaundice. Okay. In this also, you have not mentioned about any interest or signs of anything because this is you are postulating a cancer stomach, and the first primary site should be the liver. Most of the common site of malignancy in the liver is only. Stomach or the breast. These are two common malignancies that are metastatic to the liver. So there is nothing mentioned about any secondary effects on the liver. And this is not, there is no mention of...
Sir, icterus and erythrica, no icterus.
No,
because you got the node and superior there, straight away put it on go. You must rule out other things which are available or not present in the patient because it is going to prognosticate the disease. Understand?
So you are talking about pale. So, how many percentage of patients with CA stomach are anemic? Okay, so I'll just tell you because we are running out of time. 50%. So, when you examine the patient itself, you know very well the patient is anemic. That is what he said. We are more bothered up about anemia. Yes, 50% of the patients are already anemic. By the time...
Please don't take this term pallor. I'm dead against it because... We want no patient anemic. We know if the patient does not have a good red cell count, the condition is anemia. There is no pallor. Please, as a postgraduate at least, don't use this term pallor. Okay. You either say the patient is anemic or not. Understand? Pallor, when we describe, when there is an acute loss of blood, the patient loses a lot of blood and then becomes pale. At that point of time, the pallor is there. Patient's pale. In the work form is pallor. In clinical science, you should call it as anemia only. Anemic or not anemic? Whatever you say, no? Fine.
What is the relation of carcinoma stomach to anemia? Why do you get anemia? And when will anemia cause cancer?
Pernicious anemia can cause cancer.
If you have a carcinoma stomach, then how can it cause anemia? What anemia is it? Pernicious anemia, that is, in a carcinoma stomach.
The parietal cell mass of the...
That is for pernicious anemia causing cancer. How will cancer cause anemia?
The tumor passage can bleed. So
what anemia would you get there?
Microcytic hypochromic anemia.
Iron deficiency. Or the third option is a bone marrow mets. Some people consider even anemia as an inoperable case, metastatic.
Sorry for the delayed joining of the team. Is there any history of hematemesis or melena in this patient?
No hematemesis, no melena.
In a CA stomach, sir was asking about the causes of anemia. What could be the other cause?
Hematemesis.
Yeah, ulceroproliferative lesion.
Can bleeding into the
that also can cause. Okay, right. This patient has got outlet obstruction, I suppose.
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
So inspection towards the scaphoid abdomen, umbilicus was in the midline and appears to be normal. The quadrants are moving equally with respiration. And there was a fullness noted in the right upper quadrant. There was no scar, sinus, dilated veins, pulsations. The right hypochondrium. From the epigastrium, it's extending into the... Okay. Because I noticed as a fullness, so that's why I had mentioned it that way. And then flanks were free, hernial orifices were free, left supraclavicular fullness was present. The axilla, there was a node palpable and there was no pigmentation. Renal angle was free, genitals were normal. On palpation, there was no warmth, non-tender, and a mass seen in the right hypochondrium extending from the epigastrium of size 2 cm in the vertical axis and 2 cm in the horizontal axis. Irregular in surface, firm in consistency. Superiorly, it extended 3 cm below the right costal margin at the right midclavicular line. It was immediately close to the midline. I was able to insinuate my finger below the costal margin.
Whole history of presentation. See, surface you have not finished about the mass. And inspection you saw fullness, is it not? No, you will see a palpation. First thing you have to see an inspection, see a mass. Again, you are coming back on that. So you are in the next slide, you are coming into it. But this head raising test should have known what it is. You go to the next side, you say what happens. You just see the next side, what happens to the mass. No other mass palpable, no renal, percussion resonant over the pervaginal. Less prominent on head raising test.
It's an intra.
No, I want to know this mass is intraperitoneal or it's in the muscular plane. What should happen?
When you
raise the head raising test, this mass according it's there intraperitoneally. No, it's so fullness is seen. And then it's supported to the surface, then it should become decreased. Now it becomes less prominent and head raising. Less prominent and head raising, what does it say? It should be one of those intraparietal planes. It's not. Because the mass is moving with the respiration. And the mass is very small. According to it, it's only 3 cm mass in the hypochondrium. How will you know less prominent and head raising? It is very small mass.
When you're talking about plane of the swelling, your job is to seize it from the parietal wall, intraperitoneal, retroperitoneal. The moment you say it's moving with respiration, you're implying it is intraperitoneal. You don't have to do the head raising. Suppose you have a large mass and it is not moving with respiration, then you want to know, supposing if there's a desmoid or a retroperitoneal lymph nodes, then you talk about falling forward. And head raising test, leg raising test, and so on. Here you are saying movement with respiration. No, sir is trying to tell you, you don't need to do this less prominent on head raising. No.
The mass is in the right hypochondrium. So what are the possibilities, organ wise? And you are categorically saying you are able to insinuate the finger. So what is your mass now?
It could be a pylorus.
Anatomically from?
From the pylorus. Anatomically it can pylorus, be from
stomach.
The pylorus.
Okay, there is no mention of.
You are always telling everything on the other side, you know. I am able to insinuate, you are telling, okay. You are telling I am not able to palpate the liver. Why do you say liver is not palpable? I am saying, no hepatomegaly. You should say that. Instead of saying I am able to insinuate the finger into the costal margin, you should technically, because you said the mass is 2 cm mobile, then you said there is no hepatomegaly.
That is what the commonly you expect for a carcinoma stomach, no? Whether we have a secondary liver or not adjacent to it. But then you are telling we are able to, it's the other way around. Okay, you should not say like that.
No, okay.
This mass is palpable all around and you are able to insinuate the finger. So imply it is distal stomach, probably pylorus. But this is metastatic. That is, you said left supraclavicular axillary node.
Yes.
So in abdomen, I am more worried about palpable liver yet. In spite of the mass, I want to rule out palpable liver. Better say palpable liver rather than hepatomegaly.
No.
So also in spleen, you have to say palpable spleen and splenomegaly. You know very well, palpable spleen and splenomegaly is not one and the same. So in this patient, still you have to comment about liver being enlarged and seat of secondaries coming and hitting against your finger just beneath the costal margin. That brings us to the characteristics of the hepatomegaly in secondaries. That is, it's not sharp, it is blunt, the surface is irregular, you have umbilicated nodules, so you don't have
no umbilical nodules.
No liver mass. There is only one mass which is distal stomach, which is already metastasized to the left supraclavicular. And also, I expect two important points. One is VGP, other is free fluid, ascites.
No,
have you commented about ascites and the VGP?
I've mentioned about VGP, sir. So I've told flanks are free. So no free.
No,
shifting. No free fluid in the abdomen. No, okay, sir.
Certain things in clinical examination, you have to commit without any ambiguity. You have to commit in black and white, right? So, sir, let us conclude the discussion.
Investigation.
Okay, so it's a warning bell or a final bell, I don't know. Okay, anyway, we'll complete the discussion. Madam, you have given a mass, that is obviously metastatic. So where else you look for metastasis in this patient?
In the umbilical nodules, per-rectal examination,
is there any umbilical nodules?
No umbilical
then?
Nodules
okay.
Or
liver,
no
we have talked, liver is not palpable. How about free fluid?
There was no free fluid present, sir.
No free fluid. What tests you have done?
Shifting dullness.
Minimal, moderate, massive.
Shifting dullness.
Puddle sign, this thing, fluid. Shifting dullness. And, okay. Rectal examination is no deposits, no malina. Okay.
So I would like to
management,
investigate
yes.
by doing the complete blood hemogram to assess for the anemia.
No, come to specific investigations. We don't have time. Okay.
Endoscopy. Upper GI scopy, sir. I would do an upper GI scopy and see whether there's any growth present. And
That's all. Upper GI scopy, just that will do.
And staging workup, because she has a metastasis, I would go in for a CT chest, CT no, abdomen.
Upper GI scopy, scopy is sufficient.
With biopsy.
Nothing additional to your scopy.
What is the confirmative?
With biopsy.
You are supposed to do an endosonogram.
Endoscopic ultrasound.
Okay. Yes, endosonogram. So that is the thing. Our endoscopy and your ultrasound also. So that is the latest and you are supposed to do that. Okay, so that gives you more details than an endoscopy
about the
alone.
Depth of invasion.
Or your regular conventional ultrasound.
What is the information you get from my endosonogram?
We can assess the depth of tumor invasion.
You have to say transmural spread. From lumen, it can go up to serosa and go beyond that. So you have to assess that by that. Okay. So
invasion.
Also. So what is the surrounding area you'll be able to visualize in an ultrasound? So if you're going to put the endoscope, you cannot view from the head to the toe. So there'll be a limited circle, yes? Dia. So what is the diameter? It is 8 centimeters. So around 8 centimeters, you'll be able to view. Okay? So it is mostly for the invasion. And for the lymph nodes.
Lymph node.
Do you understand?
Yes.
Yeah.
Certain gastric lesions are biopsy difficult. What are they?
Diffuse gastric
cancer called as
linitis
plastica. Other lesions?
Gastrointestinal stromal tumors.
Just.
The mucosa might appear to be normal, but we will not be able to insufflate. We will not be able to insufflate while doing an endoscope.
In saying so many words, say distensibility is less.
Distensibility.
So you should, as a postgraduate, you should learn to use appropriate words that convey meaningfully that you know, right?
No, no, even here, the patient has got obstruction. So we don't know whether we'll be able to introduce the endoscope first of all. So in such patients, what do you do? What is the investigation? You said gold standard for a carcinoma stomach is endoscopy. Yes? But now this is a case where there is obstruction and you're not able to pass the endoscope beyond your, pylorus. Now what is the investigation you will do?
You can do a contrast enhanced CT.
Yes, earlier we were doing barium mean. Yes, double contrast barium mean. Now we can do a
CECT.
Yes, contrast oral. Enhanced is oral or IV?
Oral and IV.
Yes, you're supposed to do oral and IV. Yes?
Yes.
So quickly, okay. Wind up. We know it's carcinoma stomach, concede. And what is your treatment option?
This patient, since she has in metastasis and with a palpable mass, it is in advanced gastric carcinoma. We have to assess her performance score based on ECOG and Karnofsky. So based on that, I would score her as less than 60%. And
leave it all then. See, you just give bullet
points. I will give a palliation.
You will assess the general palliation. Condition of the patient. Okay, conceded. What are the other points?
I would give her a palliative treatment, sir.
It is boiled down to palliation. Palliation headings are open surgery, laparoscopy, endoscopy. Let us talk about open surgery. What is the palliation for open surgery?
We can either resect the tumor, but without any lymph node dissection, okay. Or we can go in for a feeding jejunostomy.
So there is a role for palliative resection
of the tumor.
If the tumor is resectable.
If it is resectable.
What is the single most important contraindication for any procedure whatsoever in any disseminated intraperitoneal malignancy? We have done clinical assessment, we have done imaging, yet sometimes we will have to do this test on the day of surgery beforehand.
Peritoneal cytology.
Diagnostic laparoscopy. Better learn to say all the advanced lesions, you have to do diagnostic laparoscopy, which will tell you what the others have missed. The only contraindication for any procedure will be malignant ascites. When the malignant ascites is there, no, you will not even attempt palliation. Here there is need for palliation because there are only two indications. One GA obstruction, another is GA bleed. Here it's got GA obstruction. So we can do palliation open. But that can be decided only by DLAP. If there is malignant ascites, even that is not possible. If it is not there, palliative resection. Or what is the other palliative open surgical option?
Thing you should take over from this.
Palliative resection, if the tumor is not resected, what you'll do? What is the commonest operation you perform
feeding
on inoperable?
Feeding jejunostomy.
Feeding jejunostomy, yeah.
Yeah, gastrostomy.
Technically, yes, sir. But you can do still anterior GJ. Haven't you seen most of the our patients? Our teacher, Professor Sarachandra, has said when the mass is palpable and you diagnose cancer stomach, it is a ward boy diagnosis, it is inoperable. So, even though we discuss early gastric cancer and all that, our condition, mostly patients end up with anterior GJ. Okay, fine.
Finally, the take-home point is today, all of you PG should know, if you are going to see and suspect an abdominal malignancy, whether it's colonic, ovarian or anything, please don't open. Have a D-lab before you plan any surgery. This point should be taken very well home in any intra-abdominal malignancy.
One more finer aspect is, if there is GOO and